Welcome to the fifth video in our end-to-end testing series. We'll be looking at permissive overreaching transfer trip or POTT communication assisted trip schemes in this video. I'm going to assume that you've watched all the previous videos in this series, so I won't rehash what to look for in this animation. If you have not watched the previous videos, stop now and click this link to watch them first so that you can follow along. Now that the introductions are out of the way, we can start by decoding the term POTT. The P stands for permissive. A permissive scheme tells the other relays protecting a line that they can trip faster if they also detect a fault in the correct direction. All relays must agree that there is a fault on the line before a permissive trip is allowed. Unlike the direct scheme that would send a trip signal only if one relay detected a fault, permissive schemes share information back and forth. So you will need your fancy GPS or iRig-connected equipment on all sides of the line. The O stands for overreaching. Zone 2's pickup impedance is typically set larger than the protected line, which means that one relay must measure a Zone 2 fault for this scheme to work. TT means at least one relay is sending a transfer trip signal to the other relays in the scheme. You're looking at an animation of a traditional POTT scheme that you can find on our website, relaytraining.com. There should be a link on the screen right now that you can open in a new window if you want to follow along. The link can also be found in the description below. Which elements will pick up in Relay 1 if a fault occurs close to Relay 1 as we show here? Which elements will pick up in Relay 2? Zone 1 and Zone 2 will pick up in Relay 1 because the fault is closest to Relay 1, while only Zone 2 will pick up in Relay 2. Relay 1 should trip instantaneously because of the Zone 1 pickup, but it will also send a POTT signal to the other relay because it has detected a Zone 2 or potential overreaching fault on the line. We call Zone 2 an overreaching condition because it is purposely set somewhere around 120% of the line as we described in the previous videos. Zone 2 is purposely set to detect faults in the section between the Zone 1 limit and the rest of the line. And it provides backup protection for faults on other lines in the forward direction. This means that Zone 2 will detect faults that may not be on the transmission line this relay is installed to protect. The fault is still on the line even though Relay 1 tripped and current is flowing through Relay 2. How long will it take before Relay 2 trips? Relay 2 would normally trip after a 20 to 40 cycle Zone 2 time delay in a standard impedance protection scheme. But Relay 2 received a permissive overreaching transfer trip from Relay 1. This POTT signal from the other relay gives Relay 2 permission to trip faster if it also detects a Zone 2 pickup. The permissive signal and Zone 2 pickup means that Relay 2 will trip after a short communication time delay, which is usually less than 3 cycles. Let's look at a fault that is closer to Relay 2, but this time we'll compare it to a standard distance protection scheme. This fault is a mirror image of the previous one, with the standard distance scheme on top of the screen and the POTT scheme shown on the bottom of the screen. Which elements will pick up in Relay 1 and Relay 2? This time, Relay 2 sees a Zone 1 and Zone 2 pickup, while Relay 1 sees a Zone 2 pickup. Relay 2 will trip instantaneously in both protection schemes because Zone 1 will always trip first because it has no intentional time delay. Relay 1 should trip in 20 to 40 cycles in the normal protection scheme at the top of the screen because it has detected a Zone 2 fault, which means that the fault could be on the line the relay is supposed to protect, or it could be on the line Relay 4 is installed to protect. Therefore, it's going to wait for Relay 4 to trip in case the fault is on Relay 4's line. If Relay 4 doesn't operate, Relay 2 will trip after a time delay. The POTT scheme on the bottom of the screen will not wait for Relay 4 to operate because it's getting feedback from Relay 2 that indicates the fault is on the line. If Relay 1 and Relay 2 both detect a Zone 2 fault, that means the fault should be in the overlapping region between the two relays, which is between 75 to 100% of the line. Relay 2 will trip after a short communication time delay and remove the fault from the system. A POTT scheme has pretty simple operating characteristics. If all the relays protecting a line detect a zone 2 pickup, then the fault must be on the line. Therefore, there is no reason to wait for the normal 20 to 40 cycles. However, I bet the POTT schemes installed on your sites are more complicated than what I've described here, because POTT schemes have a glaring weakness that we can demonstrate in this animation. This animation can also be found on our website and depicts POTT schemes installed on parallel lines. Current flows from right to left under normal conditions, then a fault occurs on one line. Relay 1 detects a zone 1 and zone 2 fault, while relay 2 detects a zone 2 fault. The standard POTT scheme logic applies. Relay 1 will trip with no intentional time delay, and relay 2 should trip after a short communication delay. It looks like a standard fault for relay 1 and relay 2, but let's look closer at relays 5 and 6. Relay 5 detects a zone 3 fault because there is a parallel path for current to flow into the fault, and the fault appears to be behind relay 5. Reverse zones are typically used to detect reverse faults in communication-assisted trip schemes and don't trip anything, or they have long time delays of 60 to 120 cycles. Relays 1 and 2 are going to isolate the fault long before relay 5's zone 3 gets a chance to trip anything. So far, so good. Relay 6 could detect a zone 2 fault, which has a 20 to 40 cycle time delay, so it probably won't have a chance to trip either. But it will be sending a permissive signal to relay 5. Now let's see how the relays respond to this fault. Relay 1 trips instantaneously as we predicted, but there was a source connected to relay 3, which is now sending current through relays 5 and 6. Relay 2 still detects a zone 2 fault and had received permission for the POTT scheme, so it's primed to trip after a short communication delay. The current suddenly changed direction in relay 5, so it no longer detects a zone 3 fault, and it could now be detecting a zone 2 fault. Zone 2 has a long time delay, so that shouldn't be a problem, because relay 2 should be tripping momentarily, but relay 6 was sending a POTT permissive before relay 1 tripped. Relay 5 detects a zone 2, and it could still be receiving the POTT signal from relay 6 because communication signals will always be slower than the locally processed information, such as a zone 2 pickup. This means that relay 5 could be primed for POTT operation. We now have a race between relay 2 and relay 5. If relay 5 wins that race, we could lose both lines for a fault on one line, which could be a major problem. This weakness is inherent in any overreaching communication-assisted trip scheme, and most schemes add additional logic to minimize this problem as shown in this revised drawing, where we'll start at the beginning again. Zone 3 is looking in the reverse direction and is connected to a new dropout timer, which is connected to a NOT symbol on the POTT scheme. All of the relays detect the same zones when all breakers are closed in this new hybrid scheme, and now Relay 1 detects a Zone 1 pickup and will trip instantaneously. Relay 1 also sends a POTT permissive signal to Relay 2 because it gets a Zone 2 pickup. Relay 2 should trip on POTT after a short communication delay because Relay 2 detects a Zone 2 pickup, and it's receiving POTT permissive signals from Relay 1, and it has not detected a zone 3 pickup in the last 5 cycles. Now relay 5 detects a zone 3 reverse fault and sends a blocking signal to its POTT scheme. Relay 6 detects a zone 2 pickup and sends a POTT permissive signal to relay 5. All the relays operate normally so far. Breaker 1 operates with no intentional time delay, which will cause a sudden current reversal through relays 5 and 6. Relay 5 now detects a zone 2 fault, and it could detect a POTT permissive because Relay 6 may not have had time to release its previous permissive signal yet. This was a problem in the old scheme, but Relay 5 detected a Zone 3 reverse fault a moment before, so the dropout timer will hold the Zone 3 input to the POTT scheme on. The NOT logic gate reverses the input, and the POTT scheme cannot operate for 5 cycles, which should give Relay 6 plenty of time to release its POTT permissive signal. We have now guaranteed that Relay 2 will always win the race because Relay 2 will operate after a short time delay and the fault will be isolated from the system without affecting the non-faulted line. This scheme's weakness has been beaten into submission with logic. The dirty little secret of communication-assisted trip schemes is that they all have the same operating characteristics under normal operating conditions. All end-to-end tests should be performed on either side of each protected zone to make sure the protected line is isolated faster when a communication trip scheme is applied. However, POTT schemes require additional tests that prove that the Zone 3 timer is appropriate to the application by simulating a phase reversal from both directions. Thanks for watching this video. I hope you have some new insights on how permissive overreaching transfer trip communication-assisted trip schemes work. You can play with this animation and more by following the link on the screen. You can also get more information about testing these schemes in the Relay Testing Handbook End-to-End Testing using the other link in this video or reading the description below. As always, please like this video and subscribe to our channel to let Google know that we have good stuff. It helps us get noticed and allows us to keep providing free content like this with no ads. And don't forget to have fun out there.